Okay, it's 10:25. Ready to start again. First, are there questions about the lecture before the break? Or was everything so clear that there are no questions anymore?
I have one question. Regarding to the standard that it's applied for high ultra high performance concrete, you mentioned that it's better to test in cylinder specimens than in cubic. It's what's the best size geometry?
No, that doesn't matter. The standard test is just for each country is different. I know in the US it's cylinder, in the Netherlands, also Belgium, it's a cube. But the cylinder or prism just gives you somewhat lower strength. But that doesn't mean that one is better than the other. However, also the failure pattern might be different. As you saw in a cube, you get this triaxial compression zone at the top and the bottom. So if you break it, it will start breaking at the sides. With a higher specimen, it will more break in the middle. So if you go to different materials, for instance, fiber materials, then it's maybe more fair to have a higher specimen, like a cylinder, to do your test. That is probably a more fair strength, because then the mechanism will completely change. But it's just to take that into account that your failure mechanism might be different for a different test. And also, if you go to different materials, it might be different.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Other questions for now? Or will we continue with this part, how to do such a fracture test?
For the compression test in column applications, well, in column we have some stirrups and maybe they have player confinement rules. And should we consider the over compression strength for columns in our typical designs or no, just the cubic test should be okay?
So you're actually, if you design it, you still use your strength of your concrete maybe in your design, and that's a test on the normal material without stirrups. Mm. But of course, stirrups in a structure is the reinforcement, and that will increase the capacity of your column. So it can have higher stress before it starts failing because that reinforcement is in there. So in the design, you have to take the reinforcement into account, because you can have higher loads than if it would be an unreinforced structure. But if you simply do the material test, then you do that on an unreinforced material. But yeah, there is also a difference. When is it part of the material and when is it part of the structure? Normally with reinforcement, we say that's part of the structure and the material is the concrete. But if we go to fiber concrete, then we say the fibers are part of the material. So, and then we do the test on the fiber concrete. So that's a little bit contradictory, because fibers actually also work as reinforcement in the material. But that's how we do the design, and that's, you have to take that into account. Yeah. Okay. So we have half an hour for this part, because we should finish on time, otherwise Nadana will be very mad at me. But let's try. Let's see the screen. So the content of this lecture is how do we test concrete? How do we create a crack in the material that we actually want? Because we do this research, we want to make cracks because we want to study cell feeling. We want to study how our cell feeling agents or capsules or whatever we develop, how that works in the concrete. So we want to test the cell feeling capacity of the material. And for that, we need some cracks, because we implement the self healing because we want to do something about the damage, about the cracks in the material. So we need to make a stable crack that we can use in our specimens to study them later on. So that's what we will deal with today. So what you should learn is how to make a crack specimen for your cell healing study, and also what are the parameters or requirements that you should consider when making a crack for cell healing. What should you take into account when you do a test, and that you can have a certain crack width that you can use to study your cell healing mechanism. So if we study fracture in concrete, when you said we can do compression tests or tension tests, and you need some equipment for that. For a compression test, it's normally a press that you just load in compression, you load it on the sample and you measure then the strength. Tension, you could do the same, only you have to be able to apply the load on the sample, so you should glue it or grab it in some way and then load it, put a tensile force on it. So, and then I already drawn these curves that you can get out. So the to activate my pen. So you can draw this sigma epsilon diagram. So if you apply a load on a sample and you do the test in load control, as we say, then you can measure indeed the increase of your stress, and you can measure the deformation, the strain that you can measure on the sample. So the stress you apply, the load you apply, and you measure the strain. So you can measure this curve. It will not be linear because you get micro cracking here, and you can measure up to a maximum force, because if you then keep controlling the load, so you keep increasing the load, then at this point it will fail. You can never measure what happens here in the post-peak regime, because you keep increasing the load and then it will fail at the maximum. So this is usually a normal compression test that you do to measure the strength, and then it's enough. What you also will see, you can do this in compression or in tension, you will not get a nice crack that you can use for further research, for your cell healing. So then you should not do a test in load control, because then you damage your specimen completely and then it's the end of the test. So for that you should go to deformation control, which is shown here at the right side, this one, deformation control. So what you do here is you apply again a load, compression or tension. You measure the displacement between your loading platens or somewhere on your specimen. You measure displacement or crack opening, and you put that displacement into an amplifier and a computer, and you tell the machine, so the machine that applies the load, which usually has is servo controlled or with electrical circuit is controlled, and there is a valve in there, so you can say to the machine, open this valve for the oil pressure a little bit more or a little bit less, so to regulate the load. So, and you regulate the load in such a way that you have an increase of deformation all the time, so you control actually the deformation here, you control this one, and you say keep increasing this deformation in time, and then the machine should determine the load that goes with it. So then it determines the load up to the maximum, and then the load should go down. Of course, you can also have this type of failure, or that actually the deformation in decreases, and then you can also not control this load with deformation control. So you should have a deformation that increases in time. So this type one load deformation. So then your deformation increases in time, and the machine determines the load that goes with it. And then you can stop at any time. So you can stop here. I have a crack opening of so many micrometers. That's where I stop the test. I take my sample and I do further testing with it. So that's what you need, a kind of deformation control. Of course, you can also put reinforcement in your specimen, and then you have actually a combination. So you can do different tricks with it, so that you do deformation control with rebars in it, so then they control the crack opening. So your concrete cracks, and if the concrete cracks, your rebars take over the load. And if they take over the load, you can maybe load the specimen further, and the crack opens slowly, and that's also a way to control it. So this is something in between. Well, then, if you are in a lab and you have maybe servo-controlled machines, this is how we set it up in Delft. So you somewhere have an oil pump that gives you oil pressure and that controls different machines. But you can do tests maybe in tension, like this one. This is a tensile test, and this is a three-point bending test. And in the tensile test, you can say, I will measure my deformation here. This is the displacement I measure on the sample. I give that to the machine and I tell the machine, keep this deformation, this crack opening increasing, and determine the load that belongs to it. And then you can have a stable crack running through this sample and fracture it in a nice way. The same you can do with a three-point bending. Maybe you measure the displacement here, or you measure maybe also the crack opening here between these points where this crack develops, and you give that deformation back to the machine, and that determines again the load that you apply on your specimen. And with that you can have this nice stable fracture, so up to the peak load, and then also measure the post-peak behavior. And then again at a certain moment you stop the test. Remember that then the deformation doesn't stop here, but your deformation will also go back a little bit. And this is your final crack opening. So this is deformation or crack opening, W. This is your load or stress. So you load up to a certain crack opening, let's say 50 microns. That will be my crack. I stop the test, I unload, and maybe you end up finally with only 40 microns or 30 microns. That's how it works. And it will also deform back elastically, and you have a final crack opening at the end. The length that you use to measure your crack opening is also important. Because if I have a sample, in this case it's 500 millimeter long, I load it in tension, and let's say my measuring length would be zero. I would be able to put the device here with zero length, and I measure only the crack opening. So then it would go very high straight up to the maximum, and then this is my crack opening. So for the post peak, that's nice because I have a smooth curve, but before the peak, that's not possible because it goes down very fast to this crack opening, if I control the crack opening. So that's not good. Zero length, which is also not possible, because you never know where the crack is going to appear. So zero crack length, that's difficult. Of course, you can make a notch in the sample, so a kind of pre-crack, and then you know that my crack will start at that position. So then you know already where to measure. Because if I don't make a notch, my crack can also start here. And if I measure here, then I measure no crack opening, because my crack is here. So I need to put my measuring device somewhere where my crack is going to happen. If I make my measuring device very long, so in this case, if I make it the whole specimen, 500 millimeter, so then I have a lot of elastic deformation, I reach the peak load. But then, because I have so much elastic deformation, which is outside the crack region here, that will go back, and I get this kind of curve, or I would get this kind of curve. But then you see my crack opening, which I control, which I use to control my test, is not continuous. because here it goes back. And I told the machine, keep my crack opening increasing in time. So that I can also not control the test, because here that my specimen will fail here and it will drop down and it's probably is broken completely. So I need a measuring length which is somewhere in between. So this one looks the nicest here, because then I have a nicely increasing pre-peak and a nicely decreasing post-peak behavior. And that's the easiest one to control the test. So that's important to have a right measuring length, to put your measuring device on your sample at the right location. And for that, a small notch might help, because then you know where to put your measuring device. And then you can do a stable test and you can stop it anywhere you want at a certain crack opening that you need for your test. In practice, there are several tests proposed that you can use to measure fracture energy, like a uniaxial tensile test. So you take a specimen, a cylinder or a square or a prism. You need to make some notches. You can glue it in your machine, apply tensile force, and then my crack will start here, and probably I get some micro cracks like I explained before. And the crack also starts from here. And then these micro cracks or around the aggregates, they will join up and they will finally fail your specimen. Maybe this is the nicest way to do it, to create a crack, because it's in pure tension, so you know what happens. But it's also a difficult test to control it. And you also have to glue the sample or clamp the sample, which is not easy. So this is not what the recommendation is as a standard test. Another test would be to do a wedge splitting test. So you can have a cube, maybe with an insert or a sawn notch in it, and you actually split it open. So you put some devices on top of it, and there's such a wedge determined put in, which you actually create a crack going down from here to there. So it's a kind of bending test, but you split it open by putting the wedge on the top. So this is a fairly easy test to control. You can use a standard compression testing machine. So you can control it by measuring your deformation here. So you measure the deformation, the crack opening, and that also gives you then, again, this low displacement curve like this, which you can stop at any time, and you can measure the fracture energy as the area under the curve. That is a measure for your fracture energy. The next one is a three-point bending test. So a three-point bending, where you load here, you measure, this is your support reactions. You support the beam here. You measure the deflection of the beam. You have to do that in the middle to be precise. And of course, when you load it here, you will get a crack developing in the specimen that starts from here to the top. So that's, and you can measure the deflection. You could also measure the crack opening here that will develop here and use that as feedback. Both of them you could use, or the deflection or this crack opening, to control your test, which will also give you such a nice low displacement curve. Another one to make a crack could be a splitting test. So you can take a cylinder or a cube, it's also possible. Apply a load at the top and the bottom, and then a crack will start, because you apply compression, but you, of course, you get tensile stresses in this direction. That will be tensile stresses. So your crack will develop here and then will grow upwards. But if you go too far with the crack, then it will run here into a compression zone, and this part will crack like this. So part of your specimen might break off in such a test. So you will damage, you will crumble this part of your specimen. So if you want to do later on permeability tests or something with it, or self-healing tests, then this might happen that you damage the top and bottom of your specimen. So be careful with that. If you load too far, then this will happen. If you just load a little bit, that you get a certain crack in here with a certain crack width, that is okay. But if you go too far, you might damage your specimen too much. Actually, the standard recommendation, which is recommended by Rylam, is this three-point bending test with a small notch. And with that, you can nicely measure your load displacement curve, which gives you also your stiffness of your specimen. So there's your E modulus, which gives you your strength, FT, which is actually recommended to do from a tensile test, but here you can also get it. It's a kind of flexural strength. And you get the area under the curve, which is then your GF or your fracture energy. Well, this is a G. Okay. Of course, if you do a three-point bending test and you want to control it even nicer, you can also put steel rebars in your structure, because then the test becomes easier. Then, of course, a crack will propagate, and the rebar controls the crack width. It also makes the test easier because it doesn't split that easily. And this is used by the people in Cardiff, also part of our SmartThings project that looked, well, already many years ago, about cell feeling with a glass tube inside that would break and then glue would come out. So these kind of tests can be done. Of course, interfaces are important in our materials. Nara and I will also talk about that later on. So interfaces are everywhere in our structures. They are between your aggregates and your matrix. That's an interface. But they are also between repair material and your concrete. So that causes also, that gives also an interface. And they are loaded in different ways, and they determine what happens with the structure. So it's also important to look at these, how you can test these, how you can test this interface, what kind of load is important, what kind of stress do I get. So there's a lot of literature about it, and there's not really consensus on what to do exactly, but Nana will also talk about this after the break. So what are actually now the factors, parameters that you should consider when you want to make a crack that you want to heal? Because that's what we usually want. We want to make specimens in the lab, create a crack, and then study the healing efficiency. So what do you recommend to take into account? Question to all of you. So I can write them down here. So if you give me some answers, I will put them here. What do you recommend?
Less variability on the crack, like the crack width.
Crack width, yeah. Crack width. Another one? Says crack width. Yeah. More things to consider. Think also about the lecture before the break. What did we all discuss? What is important?
Maybe the crack distribution is also open because we put some agents in our matrix, so we should be sure that the crack will hit the capsules or vascular, so the agents could be, yeah, the agents could flow in our matrix and doing healing operations.
Yeah, very good. Crack distribution, because as you saw that your material is heterogeneous, especially if you put something in like capsules or vesicles, then it becomes even more heterogeneous. So you don't get a straight crack, but it will go everywhere. So the shape of the crack, the tortuosity, it's important because it should hit your capsule or vesicle. Indeed. Something else.
Also the viscosity of the healing agent, probably. If we suppose not to have an autogenous healing, but to use a specific healing agent.
Indeed, viscosity of your agent can be important, yeah. Because that determines also what size of cracks you can fill or what kind of porosity the agent goes in. So that's an important one.
The strength or the strength in which the crack would fracture the capsule itself. So like you said, it should not crack too early or even too late, depending upon the strength of the concrete itself.
Yeah. So it's local strength and strength in time. So both are important, indeed. Strength in time.
Also the type of the damage that causes the crack.
Yeah. So the cause of damage, indeed. Because that should be related to your healing mechanism. So if you are trying to fight something which you can never fight, then your healing mechanism is maybe wrong, or sometimes you cannot solve everything. So, but that should be related so that you indeed implement a healing agent that can indeed solve the problem that you're facing in your structural material. Now let's see what I put myself. So I had these already written down. So the age of the concrete, indeed the cause of cracking. Also the size of the specimen, because we saw that we have size effect, so that should also be taken into account. The crack width that you want to heal, that's important. Also maybe the crack, if it's still under load, or maybe varying load, if the load increases, decreases, can be important. The shape of the crack, we have a V shape, straight, tortuous, discontinuous. The healing mechanism that we want to incorporate, is there transport to the crack? Because if you want to make a crack to study self healing, maybe you want to have water transport, water flow through the crack during the healing. So then you should be able to have that. And also the environment where your specimen is in, the temperature, the humidity, because that can influence the crack growth, but also your healing mechanism. So all of these things should be considered and should be taken into account. Of course, we have alternatives than making normal cracks. You could also make a crack by making a saw cut, just cut through it. But if you do that, you really have a straight crack. That's what your saw will make. So you go through the aggregates, through your interface, through your cement base. So it's not tortuous. A normal crack in the material will be tortuous, will be different in width everywhere. So it's different. But maybe for some healing mechanisms, this is okay. If you have a healing agent that should flow in, that should fill up the crack, maybe this is a way that you can create a crack by just showing the principle. Also, if you rely on continuous hydration of the crack, this would also be different because you cut through the aggregates and your aggregate will not hydrate. And a normal crack will go around the aggregate through your mortar, so there you can have continuous hydration, which will not happen in the aggregate. So if you do cutting, that's also not that nice. Placing a plate in fresh concrete could also be a way to introduce the crack, so placing a plate in it that you pull out after a few hours of hydration. But then remember that also this crack will be different, because what you then have, if this is my specimen, this was the plate that I took out. So I have a straight crack, not a V-shaped crack, which you maybe have in bending, but also my aggregates will be nicely here, and here you have small aggregates at the side. So you get a boundary effect. So it's not the same as a crack which, if I have a crack here that I make by bending, then this crack will tortures, it goes around, and you have small aggregates and big ones everywhere. So it's a different type of crack. So your healing mechanism might be different if you do it in this way. Again, for some mechanisms, this could be done, but think about the consequences. You could also restrain the specimen and then let it shrink due to temperature or humidity. So that's also a way to create a sample, that you have this imposed deformation on the specimen. You could also think about expansion of aggregate. You could play with temperature or other ways to have the aggregate swelling. You can wait for ASR, but that could maybe take 20 years and then your PhD is long over. So that is not an option, but it's an idea. You could also make a reinforced concrete specimen where the rebars are sticking out, and then you pull on the rebars and then it will crack your concrete with a certain crack spacing and a certain crack width. That's also a way to make cracks in concrete. Officially, I have only 3 minutes, so I hope Nadana will stay with us and it will not go out, and will be a little bit more. So we can do a deformation control three-point bending test, like for instance here. So this is what you measure, low displacement curve, and I already said, if you unload here, displacement will go back and you end up with a final displacement, final crack opening that you then can do for testing. We did this for a self healing study, so where we put samples that we cracked in this way. We cracked them at 1 day, so very fresh material. We put them in water to have healing and hydration, and then we cracked again the healed sample. But during healing, we actually put them in a compression device, because what we said, we can open the crack, then it stays open, but maybe then healing doesn't work that well. So we thought, well, if you put some compression on it, then the crack at least will be closed again. So it's still cracked, because there is a crack, but the crack faces are touching. And we thought, maybe let's try that to study the effect of ongoing hydration without any addition of healing agents. And then we indeed saw, if you don't close the crack, so this is when we make the crack, this is the reference sample, and the blue one is after healing. So we see we get quite a good strength, 3.5 if you compare with the reference, which was 4. Then we almost completely healed the sample, if we put compression on it. If we don't put compression, then we get some healing, because this is the curve without healing. We get some healing, but not that much, because you have a V-shaped crack in our sample, but the crack is open. And then ongoing hydration cannot heal the specimen that well. So for that, if we close the crack, then it can glue it together, but if it is open, it cannot. Of course, these mechanical tests we can do at many scales. So at sample size, mortar samples, small concrete samples, but we can also go to bigger beams, and we can go to a full-scale testing of specimens to create cracks and to see how we can heal them. We can also do very small samples. These are samples where we put capsules in that we try to heal, and these samples have a cross-section of a diameter of 1 centimeter. we loaded them in tension, and then we can also put them in the CT scanner to look where the capsules are and what happens in there. So these are very small samples that we loaded in tension to create a crack and to study them in the CT scan. Another test on a very small size is where we tested the pull-out of a single fiber out of a cement matrix. So you see the specimen here. This is the fiber. And we did that inside the electron microscope to see how the fiber is pulled out, and we measured the pull-out strength. Then we can even go smaller, so we can use the nano-indenter that Sean also showed yesterday in the video, where you can do indents in small samples. So these are actually two cement grains. You can look at them under the microscope. So you can do indents like here, all small indents. And there you measure then the stiffness and the hardness of the material locally. But you can also use this, so make an indent in a material, make a scratch, and then maybe see how those scratches or indents are filled with your self-healing agent. So that's also a way to study self-healing, to make some small damage on the surface and see how it repairs. So you could visualize that. And then finally, we also are able to make very small specimens in our lab with this dicing saw that you saw yesterday in the video, where we can make cubes, in this case of 100 micrometer cubes, that we can also damage with our nano indenter. So we can just indent it, it cracks, and you could study these cracks, and maybe also for self-healing, to see what kind of healing agent comes out, how it fills the crack. We didn't do that for self-healing yet, but that could be an option to do in the future. And then finally, we have this TSTM machine in Delft, where we can indeed study this early age cracking in a wall on a slab, for instance. So where I said this wall is heating up due to hydration, it's cooling down, and then you get these cracks in the wall, which can lead to leakage. And we have this machine in Delft where we can indeed test this in a big frame. You put the fresh concrete in it, you restrain the deformation, you can measure the stress, and at some point it will crack. And if you put also reinforcement in it, you see how the reinforcement works and how it distributes cracking and what kind of crack list you get. And that is also a way to make cracks in your sample. You could make such a structure, look at the cracks that develop, try to heal them, but you can also make such a sample and then crack your material in that way. Of course, we have the big one, and we also can do the same in the small one. So in the big one, you put concrete in, and in the small one, you put cement paste only, or mortar with a little bit of sand, and you can do the same test on a different scale, different fracture mechanism. Of course, the waste that you get afterwards, here you have a lot with the big machine. And with the small one, it's very environmental friendly, so you get only very small specimens that you have to throw away later. But you can make a nice crack and then try to upscale it from measuring through modeling to the big one. This is how we indeed cast the sample. You see with a syringe, you put the cement paste in it, you let it shrink, and then you get the small crack finally in the specimen. And there you could also study self-healing in there. A few more slides. So probably after the test, as I said, you want to create a crack, and then you would like to study permeability or through the crack or in other ways by putting it under water and see how much water it takes up. So that's something you have to consider when you study, when you make your crack, how can you do the study afterwards? By looking at permeability, doing impregnation, looking under the microscope, doing CT scans. So all these things you can do afterwards with your crack sample. And you have to consider that, of course, when designing your test, when designing your specimen, creating fracture, what are you going to do with it afterwards? That's important to take into account already before you start. So then this was my last slide. So then a summary of this lecture. Are we able to test concrete? So we I show different ways how to do that, how to make cracks. But you have to know what kind of crack do you want? What do you want to do afterwards with it? And what are the key factors so that we looked at to consider? So it's the age of the concrete, the type of material, the type of cracks that you get. Do you get a straight crack? Do you get distributed cracks? What was the cause of the damage that you want to replicate? So all these factors are important when designing a test, when designing a specimen to make a crack to study self healing. So that's what we try to go through. And then a question for the project. So if you're going to study cracks in the swimming pool, then and you want to solve that mechanism by a self healing technique, so maybe you also want to simulate the damage in the lab. So what kind of specimen, what kind of load would you apply on that specimen to get the same fracture, to get the same damage? So that's you have to consider when trying some self healing agent that you want to apply there. How do you test that in the lab? Because you want to have the same damage in the lab then that you want to repair. So for that you have to design a test. So that's the question that we want to hear from you on Friday. How are you going to do that? And this was really my last slide. So maybe we can handle a few questions if there are. Well, everything was very clear again. I don't hear anything. Then I propose that we have maybe 5 minutes break, and then Nalina will start. Is that okay, Nalina?
Yeah. No, that's okay. So let's make 11, quarter past 11.
Quarter past 11, yeah. You start. Okay. Yeah. Good.